Press the bell icon on YouTube and don't miss another update.
Hi, welcome to a new edition of Elonomics. I am YP Rajesh, Managing Editor at ThePrint, and I have with me Professor Ila Patnaik, one of India's top economists, who writes a weekly column for us called Elonomics and is also our in-house expert on all economic issues. The new government of Prime Minister Narendra Modi will be sworn in today. He's come back with a huge majority, much more than last time. There is a huge exuberance in the ruling party and the government over the return of a stable government for the next 5 years. But there are also a lot of warnings. Economists, including Professor Patnaik, have written to us and written in other publications about how how severe the challenges facing the Indian economy are. So we are going to talk today about these challenges, because along with Prime Minister Modi, we will also have a new finance minister. And the task ahead of the new finance minister, there is a budget coming up in July, and we will talk about that and much more. Ila, just yesterday we had the outgoing finance minister Arun Jaitley saying that he wants to be not considered for the new government because of health reasons. And so obviously we'll have a new finance minister taking oath and taking over his job. Does it matter who becomes the next finance minister of India, considering the challenges that faces the economy?
Listen, it's a huge challenge, but the finance minister, whoever it is, has a good team. Will need to quickly figure out what he or she wants to do for the budget, what she wants to do in terms of the long-term growth trajectory and the policy framework, mm-hmm. as well as do some preparedness and capacity building for firefighting, mm-hmm. So if there are issues that need immediate attention. Mm-hmm. So those challenges would face any finance minister. Of course, Mr. Jaitley had been in that position, so by now he had certain positions worked out. So, for example, the first thing that a finance minister faces is to make the budget, because the next budget is going to come out in July, and the FM is asked, what is the deficit you want? No, because you begin with some number somewhere, mm-hmm. and that number is usually what percent of GDP should the deficit be. Now, what I remember from when I was in the ministry in 2014, Mr. Jaitley stuck to the FRBM target. So, the 3.5% was almost sacrosanct, that while there was a lot of pressure, because people say spend more, tax less, that will help pick up the economy. But he had stuck to the fiscal targets. And I think that's the very first thing that a finance minister needs to make up her mind about. That what do I do in terms of the fiscal stance? Mm-hmm. Is it expansionary? Is it going to be contractionary? Or do I try to, balance somehow?
But is that the first big challenge at this point of time, Ila? Because the talk is all about a slowdown. There is not enough consumption, there is not enough credit offtake. So is the fiscal deficit or the fiscal responsibility the biggest challenge right now, or is it more about boosting consumption, ending or at least making sure that the slowdown doesn't become very deep?
So, there are always trade-offs, and it's very difficult to make out. So, let me try and explain here why the two are connected. So, let's say that the finance minister believes that this slowdown in consumption is for real, and therefore there needs to be expansion. Now, expansion can be some government expansion, some private expansion. So, what are his policy options? Spend more. So every government department, especially the social sector departments, will say you need to spend more, put money in the hands of people, and then demand will rise and the economy will pick up. The infra sectors will say roads, shipping, airports, transport, spend more on infrastructure, public investment in infrastructure will have externalities, and so spend more. Okay, so one is this challenge of deciding if he has to spend more, then where does the spending come from? The second challenge would be if he spends more, does he tax more or does he borrow more? Mm-hmm. Otherwise, how is he going to spend more? Let's say he taxes more. Mm-hmm. Now, while on the one hand, you were trying to push private investment and spending, on the other, if you tax more, then post-tax returns to investment go down. So let's say you raise corporate taxes. You know, income taxes and increasing income taxes is usually very unpopular. So none of us want that done, right? So if you start pushing up, and GST I think is already, it's not going to be increased. We understand that that has to be reduced if anything. So then does he push up corporate taxes? If he pushes up corporate tax rates, is private investment going to increase?
Which has always been a problem already.
Which is already a problem. So that's where it becomes very difficult. Mm-hmm. Because if you're thinking, oh, I'll increase public investment by pushing up tax rates, but that would reduce private investment, so you don't know what the net effect on the economy is going to be. Now similarly, let's say he says, I'll borrow more. Okay, I don't want to tax more, so I'll borrow more. He borrows more and interest rates can go up. So if interest rates are pushed up, again private investment gets hit. So what is the net effect going to be? So this decision, they're very linked, that if you think you're going to have an expansionary budget to take care of the slowdown, you need to figure out how you're going to pay for it and what is going to be the effect of your financing decisions on private spending and investment. Only then can you figure out what the effect on the economy as a whole is going to be, and that's what he's trying to address at the end of the day. So that's why I said it's, you know, a huge challenge. Mm-hmm. And this fiscal deficit number is really very critical. It's a very critical element of this whole story.
So what, according to you, Ila, would be a ideal solution? What would you do if you were in the hot seat tomorrow?
So what you would do is you would listen to all the departments, because each one is going to come up with some spending scheme. Ministries come up with various spending schemes, and then you form your view on which is the most efficient way, which is going to be the most effective way to spend. Okay? Because every rupee that you spend should go into something that pushes up the economy, that gives you jobs and growth. At this time, I think that's critical. And yet does minimum damage in the long term. So if you spend all your resources on, say, building or these additional resources, whatever is the extra in the budget that you want to spend on projects like roads or projects which are going to in health, education, I mean, there's so many competing uses for money. So if you're going to choose from among those, you want it to be where it is going to be most effective. And, you know, nobody has an answer, because there are trade-offs involved. After all, should I spend money on health or should I spend money on roads? Okay. So these decisions become to some extent technical, that you don't want a badly designed project and money to just go down the drain. But these are also political decisions, because governments come in making promises. And not just making promises, also planning how they want the policy framework and the trajectory for the economy to be. So if they're going to be focusing on public investment, or if they're going to be focusing on, you know, so Congress had promised a Nyay scheme,
right.
So they would have done transfers according to that, or farm debt.
Yeah.
debt waivers,
yeah,
or subsidies, or toilets, or so there are the.
So that was my next question, Ila. So many of, you know, of the promises made during the election campaign, both sides made a lot of promises, so did the, you know, BJP. Do you see a lot of these welfare decisions and SOPs and waivers kind of moves being front-loaded into the immediate future, or do you think those will come much later or should come much later, if at all?
See, what we saw with the previous regime, since it's a continuation of the same government, so to try and answer your question, if I look back, then the infrastructure for transfers was laid down pretty much in the beginning. Okay, so the Jandhan accounts and the scheme was created. And then the next few years were spent on trying to improve delivery through those schemes. And in some ways that is a very effective strategy. If you start in, say, year four, you would be left with people who are expecting something, but you're not really able to deliver because, you know, setting up delivery systems in government is a big challenge. And if you start early, then, you know, you learn from your mistakes, you figure out how to get money down to the last mile and the household. And that's, I think, been what we saw in the first year. So I think the infrastructure building will start now, but the actual delivery and expenses will take some time. You know, even for cash transfers to farmers, you need records. You need to know who has these 2 acres of land, or now if you're promising more than that, then you need names. You need names linked to bank accounts.
Some states have done it, some states don't have those.
Yeah, records. It's then they don't exist everywhere. Yeah. So you start building the infrastructure and then you're effective by the time you face the next election.
The other talk which you yourself, the point you've made is about structural reforms, you know, the second generation of reforms, because the reforms of the early 90s have lived their life and, you know, they will not help us anymore. So what do you think that can, you know, that needs to be done on that front in the first few months? Again, obviously everything cannot be done in the first few months, but to start off with, people have talked about land and labor and credit and capital. So, anything you expect that needs to be done in the first burst?
So, you know, if I go back to the 91 reforms, they were product market reforms. So, it was reforms about trade, that you could trade more, you could import more, basically. So, you removed restrictions on import licensing, import licensing was removed, and tariff rates were brought down over the years. Domestically also, you removed restrictions on industrial licenses and how much each company could produce. You know, we used to have these huge restrictions on production. So those were product market restrictions. But what we didn't do at that time, and that was focused on manufacturing, what we didn't do at that time was agriculture. So that's one major area where the Essential Commodities Act, it still exists. It allows the it's a wartime act. It allows the government to say that you can't hold more than, let's say, X kgs of rice, 150 kgs of rice. Now, you won't develop the warehousing capacity to do that. So, agriculture, APMC, I mean, while there can be a lot of discussion about whether it's good or bad, but if you look at the principle, then the farmer can only sell to APMC. If I'm a farmer and you're my neighbor, I legally cannot, I don't have the freedom to sell to you. So agriculture needs a lot of reforms, like the early 91 reforms, where, you know, it was clear that you need to give people freedom. So that's one area. And then factor market reforms, land, labor, capital. I mean, all three factor markets, you need to be clear what reforms you want, even preparing a bill. Tabling it in parliament takes time, so wherever the central government has to do, so I've worked a lot on financial sector reforms, and you know, we need a bond market, we need a government bond market, we had made some beginning with the public debt management agency, we need to take that forward. We also, like, you know, there's a bankruptcy code for real sector firms. Similarly, a bankruptcy code for financial firms or the Resolution Corporation, FRDI bill was proposed, but because of various misunderstandings that had been withdrawn. So that needs to be amended and brought back on the table so that, you know, if there are these NBFCs which are in trouble now, go bankrupt, then there is a way to resolve them and not and to minimize the impact on the rest of the system and consumers or depositors and so on. So those are for financial markets, some are there. I think similarly for land, and what with so many BJP states, you know, there can be a model labor law if politics allows it. So you need to go into those factor market reforms and agriculture. Those are, I think, priority areas for legislative reforms?
One of the areas which the last 5 years of the Modi government got probably right was addressing bad loans, because they finally started getting banks to look at their bad loan book and go for haircuts, or consider taking bankrupt companies to the IBC. How do you see that process moving forward? And there is also talk about larger banks taking or merging smaller banks and creating these 5 or 6 or 7 huge public sector banks. How do you see that process moving?
So I don't think it made a lot of progress last time. Mm-hmm. When we began in 2015, you had about 7-8% of GDP was bad loans. But we didn't immediately address that issue, and that kept increasing, because you just leave a bad loan and it accumulates interest, and that went up to 10-12% of GDP. So that went up. The RBI came up with this February 12th circular, which later was struck down. So I feel that the flaw was in the regulatory and supervisory capacity of RBI, where for a long time we just kept kicking the can down the road and allowing banks one mechanism or another. So there was this CDR, SDR, S4A, and so on, an alphabet soup of schemes that allowed banks to kick the can down the road, not recognizing their bad assets. Now, after the February 12th circular is also not going to be there, what is required is, I think, RBI's regulations and its supervision to be much stronger, so that banks have the incentives to take companies to IBC. They have also, when I say stronger, I mean that if a loan goes bad, you have to completely mark it down. Maybe you can take it down to its value to zero on your books. And then if you recover something after the IBC process, you will put some of that money back into your equity capital. That way, banks will have the incentive to go through the IBC process, rather than to say, oh, now it's a 40% and then a 30% and that's the value. So they would be pushed to clean up their books. And I think there's a lot of work required to be done there.
Last question, Ila, which is a question which affects all of us much more than anything else probably. Do you think there is a possibility of the government, because of the situation it finds itself in, fiddling with tax rates at this point in time, because also the people can swallow the bitter pill now because there is no election coming up in the near future. Do you see any of that happening right now? Because we saw the last budget, they fiddled with tax rates, keeping in mind the elections and giving some kind of rebates to people under 5 lakhs and all of that.
See, what they need to do now, and especially because we have the analytics capacity and computing capacity, and this is being done in other parts of the world, what they need to do now is to also look at other databases, other things that households do, and to reduce tax evasion rather than to fiddle with the rates. So, it's much easier for a tax department to increase in, suppose their revenue targets are bigger, their tax collection target is bigger. It's very easy for them to say, yes, increase the tax rate, because it's just a stroke of the pen, one signature and the tax rate goes up. But what is much harder is to catch people who are evading taxes and to put in place systems which match your expenditure, whether it is on through credit cards, whether it is on your lifestyle on Facebook, or there are many ways through which all that data can be triangulated, put together, where the tax department can go after tax evaders. Rethink whether all of agricultural income, even at higher levels, should be taxed or not, because that provides a loophole. So I think what should be done, and that would be in the spirit of the attempts to reduce tax evasion and black money, that what should be done is not to increase the tax rates, but to reduce tax evasion through the many means, rationalizing tax rates, reducing loopholes through which people evade taxes, data systems and analytics through which the tax department can go after people. So I hope it's that and not raising
what should be done and what will be done. There is always a gap between the two, and we will come back with another edition of Elonomics next week and tell you what exactly the new finance minister has said and what it means, and what are the implications, what is his vision for the next 5 years of this government. Thank you, Ila, and please keep watching us.